I think it's still morning, yes. Okay, I am the project coordinator for BioLine International, and I've been working in this capacity for about the last 6 years, and I work very closely with my colleague Leslie Chan, whom some of you will be a little more familiar with than myself. Today, I'm going to touch on some of the experiences that BioLine has had in the last year, because we have launched a new membership model. And in the spirit of the conference, which we've already discussed a little bit, we think it's important to share our experiences in the hope that you can benefit from it in your endeavors. So just a quick overview of the presentation. I'm just going to give a little introduction to BioLine in case you're not familiar with us. I'm going to talk a little bit about our old and our new funding models. And then we have some questions that we want to pose sort of to the general community just for thought. And I'd like to outline our success so far, some of the challenges, and then I'll conclude. So to start with, just a brief overview of BioLine International. Let me take my notes here. First off, we have been operating since 1993, so I kind of get a little freaked out every time I look at that number, but it's actually 16 full years. We currently host about 70 journals, all published in the developing world, and that's various areas of the developing world, from Africa to India and other areas. We cover about 16 countries total. All of our journals are fully open access, and it is a collaborative effort between BioLine in Toronto, which is where I'm located, and our volunteer server administrators, and they are at the Center on Environmental Information in Brazil. So you can see on the slide here, these are our main 3 points in our mission. Okay. Most importantly to know about BioLine, we are not-for-profit. Okay. We're not regionally based or supported by any sort of regional government. We're really a very grassroots initiative, and we're based on distributed support at this point. Our subject area focuses on bioscience, so we work in health and medicine, crop science, animal sciences, and related fields. All of our publishing partners that come from the various countries are all nonprofit. Some of them get their funding from institutions, some are just independent. A lot of them rely a lot on volunteer work and volunteer support. And some of them still maintain a dual mode. They have print subscriptions that they get a little bit of money from, and they also participate open access on BioLine. We don't charge any fees to our publishing partners. It's our aim to help them. We provide a non-exclusive platform, so if they participate in BioLine, we encourage them, if they're able to run their own website in conjunction, to participate in other similar initiatives. And just basically, the whole point is to get that material out there and get people using it. A little bit of BioLine's added value, because you might be thinking, if they have their own websites, why participate in BioLine? We like to think that we offer a little bit of a prestige factor because they have been accepted into BioLine. We offer our connections to the journals, so they do end up getting linked by major universities that might not necessarily consider the journal. And we are open archive compliant, so they do get the benefit of enhanced metadata. Okay, so this one journal that seems to be in the ocean isn't really, but unfortunately, because the internet was down last night, I couldn't fix this graph. This is just to give you a basic overview of where the BioLine journals are located, and they're all published in those countries, and we correspond with them primarily through email, and in some cases we still get CDs and discs via regular mail. Okay, so a little bit about our funding model. This has been sort of a project of the last 2 years that Leslie and I and a number of colleagues have worked and worked and worked on, trying to find something that works for BioLine. We really support the project. We know it's good. We have people that tell us that they appreciate our project. But as you all well know from running your own initiatives and from these talks, funding is always the problem. So in the past, BioLine has existed in a number of different sort of business models. And a lot of them bunch together too. We started off originally with some paid access material and some some open access material. In fact, BioLine launched 3 online-only journals in the early ages of the project just to do a bit of an experiment to show the scholarly community what could be done with these online journals and interlinking and metadata. We've also had a few institutional subscriptions, and of course we've had University of Toronto support, and then there are occasional grants that we've received. Now, each of these models comes with some difficulties, which again we've seen in some of the other presentations. Unfortunately for the pay-per-view model, we found that though there were people requesting some of these journals, some of the articles, the cost to actually collect the money and process it and then send it back out to the journal, which was our original intent, ended up being more than what we actually brought in per article. In terms of institutional subscriptions, we all know the difficulty here. It's limited access for only the people within those institutions. University of Toronto support has been fantastic, but at this point, we're at a point where we want to diversify our funding and sort of make BioLine a much bigger project, which we think we need to draw funding from external sources and to really diversify the funding across a large group. Again, occasional grants. We only get those occasionally. Okay, so our new business model, which we launched about a year ago today, is based on building a distributed support model. We evaluated a number of different models. We had some excellent help from Spark, who really worked with us for several months trying to develop and really investigate the various different options for us. We looked into a usage trigger model, which would mean that if your institution was using the project's resources over a certain level, it would come back to you saying we'd like you to support. We looked into charging the publishing partners, which we really, really didn't want to do because our goal is to support them. And we looked into journal twinning and also sponsorship and membership. So we decided on the sponsorship and membership model as the most likely to succeed. We've seen this really doing wonderful things for the DOAJ, and we were hoping that we might be even partially as successful, we would be doing well. So, these seem to be out of order. Okay, so in our quest for this new business model and speaking with librarians and scholarly organizations, we really find that, as many of you have pointed out, that there needs to be a really large change in paradigm shift. We need to be thinking about what really counts when we're talking about funding OA initiatives. We've talked a lot about article charges and publication fees, but for BioLine, because we deal with the journals after they've already been published, we need to support our project so that we can bring these journals to everyone else in the world, as opposed to just supporting the publication of one individual issue. So, we'd like to bring forth the idea of scholarly journals as a merit good, meaning that perhaps these may be a good that the government needs to subsidize or support because there isn't enough support from society and from individuals themselves. So the government needs to subsidize some. The usual comparison is to the field of education, where in many countries the government subsidizes because there isn't sufficient contribution from the public, though we all agree that the information and the use of education is high. We want to broaden the term, the definition of success and value when we're looking at open access journals. And we've just prepared a few notes here. You know, traditional value is based on economic return. Scholarly value is traditionally based on reputation and citation. Institutional value, well, we have a public mission. Social value, equity, participation, and diversity. And political value, evidence-based policy, transparency, and accountability. Okay, so in our terms, we'd like to pose out to you that we think we should be thinking about questions such as what counts as input, as costs or investments? What counts as output or the benefits and the impact of what we're doing? traditional accounting really focuses on, as you know, the bottom line, shareholder value, and the actual financial gain. Whereas projects like BioLine can't necessarily be measured in economic terms. We don't generate any revenue. We're a nonprofit, and our benefit, as we see it, is looking at lives being saved because medical information has gotten to someone that might not necessarily get it. Crop production practices have been improved because this information has been shared across borders that normally wouldn't necessarily have access to it. So in terms of BioLine's social impact, I just have a quote here from one of our publisher partners from African Health Sciences. And it points out and it kind of highlights some of the challenges that publishers in these parts of the world encounter. Not to pick on anyone, but he does say, for example, at BioLine, because we are we provide a service, we take files from the journals and we help them process them and get them online. And they're saying BioLine doesn't require us to do expensive and laborious XML and other conversions. Now, our hope in the future is that we can work with journals, helping them to sort of advance their skills and to take on more and more of the work. And certainly across our range of journals, we have a lot of very different technical skill levels, and we do work individually with each of the journals to sort of improve and push them along in that capacity. So I'd like to talk a little bit now about our success so far with our new business model. As I mentioned, we launched the business model around this time last year. We're just entering in October into the second year. So it wasn't the greatest economic climate to do this. People didn't have a lot of money. However, I'm really confident that our outcome was a lot more positive than we thought it would be once the economy started to take a downturn. So far, we have a list of founding sponsors who signed on to give us one lump sum just to get us into this new publishing model. And the nice part about being here today is that I'm going to find that there are representatives from some of our supporters, and I can actually say thank you because I don't usually get out of the office. So it's nice to be able to see people face to face. So far, the Open Society Institute, Science Commons, Simon Fraser University, University of Ottawa Library, University of Guelph Library, and York University Library, they have all supported us with a one-time fee. And then we're very, very pleased to add GIST Collections onto our list of consortial members, and this is just recent. And we also have OCO, which is, for those of you that don't know, that's the consortium of Ontario University Libraries. Now, members is where things start to look really nice and full on the spreadsheet, and I'm very pleased to highlight Max Planck Digital Library, who joined on with us last week, so we're very pleased to hear from them. I believe we also have someone from Ghent Library here, and of course Lund. I believe there's also someone from the Wellcome Library. And is anybody? I think. Not sure. Certainly, we have been, again, in light of the economic downturn, we have been really, really pleased to have this type of support come forth in the very first year of this membership model. So, in terms of the actual website, this graph is not the clearest, but this shows BioLine full text downloads, and that is the actual access of people to the full text of the article, okay? And it's been adjusted to remove search engines as much as possible. So a couple of things to note on this graph. We became open access in January 2004, so you can see the big jump in interest in our papers. And the last figure for 2009 only shows the statistics up to July because that was all that was available to me. So, looking at this map, which is probably a little bit hard to see at the back, this is over the past month of BioLine, and it just shows the allocation of visitors to BioLine. So you can see there's a very strong presence from the developing world, which is one of our missions, to make sure that information is being transferred from the south to the south, as opposed to just taken from the developed countries and pushed into the developing countries. Here are some of the stats that go along with that map, and because this is just from the last month, we're very interested to notice that London has gotten right up to the front there. We are not sure if that has anything to do with Max Planck and just signing on with us, but we're very happy to see them there. Over time, if you look at a chart from about the last year or two, you'll see that 5 out of 10 of the top cities that are accessing BioLine are actually developing countries. So we're very happy to see the visitors both from the developed and the developing world. It really shows us that information is being exchanged the way we'd like it to be. In terms of journals that applying to join BioLine, it's fluctuated, but we notice a steady incline. In 2007, we actually received a grant to add 10 new journals, and that is why there's such a huge spike that year, because we actually put out a call for journal applications. Normally, we get most of our publicity by word of mouth, and we don't actually go out and look for journals. So, okay, so a few of the challenges and opportunities coming out of this new business model. First off, we came up with a lot of questions that I'm sure a number of you have really encountered over the past little while with your own ventures. Why pay for open access is always the big one. Why would we pay if the material is open access? We got this question mostly from libraries, and this is where we start to urge a little bit of a change in the thinking process. We would like libraries to start thinking of themselves instead of a purchaser of content in the electronic environment, that they should start thinking about ways that they can become more active. And I know that yesterday in some of the breakout sessions, we were discussing the idea that consortia could maybe act as an intermediary for libraries and help them to move into a role more of a supporter rather than just a purchaser or a licensee. They really need to think about scholarly output, and we all know this because it's come up in many of the presentations. Think about where we're going, and we are supporting the research process, but not necessarily the output and access to the output of that research. So it was very, very good to see a lot of the presentations talking about organizations that are now turning their focus in that way. A lot of people asked us why their membership is different from a subscription. And in our case, we're able to say your membership helps support access to everyone for this. And I think that's, again, a theme that has come up a lot over the past couple of days. And it's basically libraries, they have the opportunity to rethink their role in terms of the broader global context here. They don't have to support just their own patrons with the money that they are giving for institutional subscriptions. They can support patrons across the world by contributing to open access. So just to review, our suggestions in terms of the roles of research libraries, no longer just buyers of content, and that they may be partners in the creation of these merit goods. They can be funders of scholarship, as we've seen many times across these presentations. And we suggest that collection development should become more of a strategic investment process. And supporting fees for projects such as BioLine is more of an investment in symbolic capital rather than just licensing access to some information from other paid resources. So in conclusion, obviously, as we've seen in so many of the presentations, there's a need for a different framework for accounting for open access, but especially when it comes from publications from the developing world. We need to rethink what counts and how we can support that collectively in order to improve scientific research coming from all areas of the world, not just the developed countries. So our contact information. Any questions?
Jen, what I'm going to say may sound harsh.
That's okay.
You do a wonderful job. The bigger journals, we do benefit from those journals. But I am concerned that I don't think you're putting enough pressure upon your publishing partners in the particular countries to use the social accounting model in order to get more money from their own governments. I don't see your business model being sustainable in the long run. Now, some of your countries really are poor, but others, you know, do have money. It's just within the country, the money is not being directed towards things like the BioLine journals. Where, I mean, in countries like US, Canada, UK, we're having to face up to how we pay for the open access journals that we produce.
Mm-hmm.
Are you putting enough pressure upon your publishing partners to do the same in their countries? That's my question.
I think that's definitely a very good point in this argument. We certainly, myself, I'm usually not the person doing the presentations, it's usually Leslie, but I know that he travels extensively and he does actually get to work with the journals a little more hand in hand, and I definitely think that that's a good suggestion, that he needs to be going back to them and telling them and helping them to develop ways in which they can develop that, because you're right, I mean, there is money there in some of the locations. We don't deal with just one developing country, so it's definitely a range, and some of the countries are definitely transitional, which means that they are better off and there are more opportunities. So that's definitely a very valid point, which I'll take back to our sort of table of conversation about the business model, which is evolving. Thank you.
One thing which struck me is, given your profile where your publishers are, have you thought about the idea of talking to governments via their development aid programs? Because, I mean, it's something like 0.5% of GDP which goes to development aid, which goes part into the same sort of countries as here. Now, there's a lot of discussion about all the problems with development aid, all the corruption on the way, mm-hmm. all the overheads and intermediaries, and this would be a very direct way of doing it.
Yes, that's definitely an option as well. We know that in terms of BioOne itself, we have a very difficult time obtaining funding from government organizations because our management office is located in Toronto. So we don't qualify for some of the money that's available through, for example, the IDRC in Canada. However, we're looking at new partnerships in the next couple of years where we try to encourage some of our publishing partners to do more of the work and hopefully look into that type of grant and provisions for them.
All right. Well, please join me once again in thanking Jeff.